Good evening, everyone. Welcome to the Art Gallery of Hamilton tonight. My name is Laurie Kilgore-Walsh, and I'm the Senior Manager of Education here at the Gallery, and I am very pleased to welcome all of you to our special event tonight. Before I turn the microphone over to our guests, I just wanted to let you know of a few things. First of all, the Beaver Hall exhibition, which we are talking about today, is open for viewing until 9 o'clock, so you'll have some time to go and see the exhibition following this talk if you haven't already done so. And I do highly recommend going to see it. It is a beautiful exhibition, and we've had a really wonderful response to the exhibition itself and also our programming, such as events tonight. The next event in this series is a little less than a month from now, on Thursday, April the 7th. Our talk titled Shared Vision, A Conversation About Artist Collectives will be here at the gallery. And we are welcoming two contemporary artist collectives to come and talk about their practice with our Director of Programs and Education. So for that event, we have artists Svava Thordis-Julissen and Margaret Flood from FNOR. And I think Svava is here tonight. Welcome. And also Liz Platt and Claudia Manley from Shake and Make Collective. And Tor Lukasik-Foss, who is our Director of Programs and Education, is also a member of the THUB Collective. So please join us for that event. And the final talk in the series is on Thursday, April the 28th. Dr. Christina Uno from Concordia will be here talking about the idea of gender in the group. In the Beaver Hall group. I nearly said the group of seven. Excuse me. So that talk, as well as men, gender in the Beaver Hall group, will be another one. Again, that's April 28th. Now, please join me in welcoming our special guests as I turn the mic over to Tobi and Melissa.
Hello, everyone. Thank you all for joining us. It's a great turnout. My name is Tobi Bruce. I'm Director of Exhibitions and Collections here at the Art Gallery of Hamilton. And for those of you who were here for Jacques Desrochers' talk a few weeks ago, forgive me, I'm going to repeat a little bit of what I said. Jacques is the co-curator of the Beaver Hall exhibition, and he gave a talk just before the exhibition opened. And I do so by way of trying to set context for tonight's program. When this exhibition was offered to us about 4 or 5 years ago, the fact that we would present the Beaver Hall show here in Hamilton wasn't a given. And that's not because, you know, there was no question as to the strength of the work. We wanted to present this extraordinary group of paintings together here, brought together for the first time in Hamilton. But the question that was given to us, posed very legitimately, was, but will anyone in Hamilton know who the Beaver Hall group is? This is Ontario. We are the land of the group of seven. Ontario, honestly, where's the group of seven? Where's the group of seven? Where's the group of seven? And, you know, our response was very much so, well, this is the Quebec group of seven. So we found reference points, ways that we could talk about this body of work so that there was a touchstone for people who knew the group but might not know their contemporaries in Montreal. So the work itself, and if the last 2.5 weeks is any indication, Hamiltonians and Southern Ontarians, they know Beaver Hall. You've come out to support this exhibition in ways that are so affirming for us, so thank you. So there was no interest in, the strength of the work and the history of the making of the work, there was no question. But from the standpoint of us as an institution, Laurie and Tor, who's our new Director of Programs, and Melissa Bennett, Curator of Contemporary Art. That was my introduction of Melissa. We've been thinking a lot about how do we work with historical exhibitions, historical work, to bring it alive now, to make it present, to make it relevant. And when we thought about the group of seven, when we thought about the Beaver Hall group, when we thought about the Beaver Hall group project, there were two very evident forces that sort of came to the surface. The first was this incredibly forceful contingent of women artists that were part of the group, that in fact made up half of the group of Beaver Hall, and also this notion of a community of artists working together. And those two elements in concert with one another, they're very much intertwined, and they're so integral to the importance of this group, because when we think about the Beaver Hall women painters, they formed 50% of the group. And that parity is what made that group so progressive and so modern. Had they been a group of women artists on their own, we think, for instance, of the Women's Art Association of Canada that was formed in the late 19th century, a women's only group, whether you like it or not, runs the risk of being dismissed. The fact that these women made up were made up in a whole group with men, actually put them on the same professional level. This community thereby allowed them to work together in a space as women, but also with their male colleagues. So they were sharing studio space, they were exhibiting together, they had a forum for discussion, critique, debate. It essentially provided them with a world in which they could be professional painters. And this is so important to remember because this was the 1920s, and these women, Prudence Heward, Lilias Torrance Newton, painting those nudes that were so challenging in their day, were painted by women who still didn't have the vote in Quebec. Okay, we got the vote in 1918, but Quebec didn't get the vote, women didn't get the vote until 1940. The images that they painted, both the women and the men, also had a consistency to them. They were portraits, they were figure works, and they were urban landscapes. Also rural scapes, but less so. If you look at the exhibition, you'll see where that balance lies. And so in thinking about an event tonight where we could bring together some very important painters in our community, we're thrilled to bring together three women who 100 years later are still looking at those same pictorial concerns with their work, the portrait, the figure, the urban landscape. So I'm going to tell you a little bit about how the night's going to unfold, and then I'm going to turn the mic over to Melissa. We've invited all of our artists, who Melissa will introduce one by one, to give a brief outline of their practice, to give all of you a sense of what they do, a little synopsis, 5 minutes. Then we ask them to choose one work from the exhibition and speak to that work and why they chose that work in light of their practice. Then we're going to open it up for conversation between Melissa and I and our painters, and then we're going to open up the floor to all of you to ask questions. It's very casual. We have three people who are artists. They are not public speakers. Speaking publicly is incredibly stressful. So be kind. They're lovely women. They're highly intelligent. They have great things to say. See, look, how can you be daunted by this? Is that lovely? So that's all I'm going to say. I'm going to turn it over to Melissa, and she will start the introductions.
So we have the wonderful slideshow, basically, a selection of images by each of the artists, but we also have an original painting by each of them as well, just so you can get a sense of the real thing. So I'll start with Katherine MacDonald, and this is her painting just to the left of Christina. So left to right here, first of all, Andrea Kastner, Katherine MacDonald, and Christina Sealey. So Katherine MacDonald will begin talking about her incredible practice as a lifelong Hamiltonian. So Katherine MacDonald was born in Hamilton. She studied at Mount Allison University in Sackville, New Brunswick, which Andrea did as well, McMaster University, and she teaches at the Dundas Valley School of Art and at Sheridan Institute in Oakville. She's been exhibiting since the mid-1970s with solo exhibitions at the Art Gallery of Hamilton, the Carnegie Gallery, and the DeFasco Gallery in Dundas. And her work has been included in numerous group exhibitions in Southern Ontario and is in the collections of the Art Gallery of Hamilton, including this work here, the Art Gallery of Sudbury, the Hamilton Club, and private collections in Canada and all over the world. And it should also be noted that she's the daughter of T.R. MacDonald, who was the first director and curator at the Art Gallery of Hamilton, who was instrumental in establishing the collection of modern works, including by Prudence Heward, that are on view here today. So your connections go back even further. And that was one invitation, one reason to, it was so obvious to choose you to participate today because of that connection as well. But also for the incredible paintings that she produces, many of which are portraits. So I'll scroll through if you would like to speak a little bit about them, and then we'll move on to the next artist after.
I think I'm going to be hurling this thing around with the wire. I'm also the daughter of Ray Hendershot, who was an extraordinarily fine and underrated painter. So I thought I'd mention that as well. When I was trying to gather my thoughts for this evening, particularly in terms of talking about my work, which I always have a hard time doing. I think it comes of growing up in Southern Ontario in the 1950s and the 1960s, and you just don't push yourself. I went back and I reread the essay that Tobi wrote for the show that I had at the McMaster Museum in 2010. And it was so, I hadn't read it actually since, I never read it in the catalog. I read, you sent it to me and I read it. And I haven't read it since. It's hard, I find it hard to read things about myself. But it was so kind and so generous and so kind of caught the spirit of what it is I'm trying to do in my work that I felt as if I should actually just sit here and read it aloud instead of trying to say something else. But it was kind of funny because I was remembering conversations that we had while you were writing this and we were talking about the work and so on. And one of the things that I remember was that you said I was an anachronism. And she doesn't actually use that word in the catalog, but it is there, and it is true. I am an anachronism. I'm a figure painter who still works with a live model and not a photograph. And it's increasingly unusual. So it is anachronistic. And I suppose, really, no one aspires to be an anachronism. You know, mommy, when I grow up, I want to be an anachronism. But I do have, probably one of my less endearing characteristics is a kind, to which my family will attest, is a kind of stubbornness. And I think that is what has allowed me to continue to be myself, to do the work that I've wanted to do in an art world that I find, in general, at its best condescending and at its worst, actively hostile and destructive. So on that happy note, let's look at some pictures. This one, Tobi and Melissa asked us to at one point, Christy and I worked with each other, and Melissa and Tobi asked us if we would bring in some examples of pieces that we had done. And I think it was you approached me. You asked me if I would be interested. And I was at her apartment, and she had some photographs of her wedding and this amazing wedding dress. The skirt is, it was your great-great-grandmother's. And it had, there was a jacket as well, and then which she wore, and then she had this top that went underneath. And when I saw the pictures, I thought, oh, that is so amazing. I would love to paint that. Mm-hmm. So when she talked about painting, I thought, well, that would be perfect. I was looking at it the other day and thinking, it is rather odd. There she is standing there in her wedding dress in my studio with all of the paintings and drawings and things around in the screen. I mean, it's not really where you expect someone to be in their wedding dress. But it was one of those paintings that I had, I think I had a fairly clear idea in mind. I could see it in my mind's eye before I started it, and of course there are always changes. But that one I had a really strong image of. I can't believe I did it so long ago. It's nearly, it was 2001 or something like that. We're not getting any older. And this one I did a few years later. This is also Christina in the studio. This is a little bit bigger. This one is much more recent. It's actually the same size as the first one of Christy. I'm always surprised when you look at paintings that are exactly the same size, how different they can look depending on what the actual image is. You have something in your mind and they think, oh, it's much smaller than that, or it's an entirely different shape and they're the same. When I look at things later on, I don't remember usually what I was thinking at the time, why I chose to do what I did. I do remember this one was a struggle. I think I wanted to paint white. It was this summer, so if I'm thinking about color, I don't want to paint black in the summer. I don't want to paint dark red. I want something light. I When I teach, I think I have, I always say to my students, I only have three things that I say. I just say them over and over and over and over again. And one of them is stand back, get back, look at your picture from a distance. I did not do that with this painting till quite far along, at which point, when I got back, I realized that the legs were far too long and I had to repaint them. And repainting bare feet is not what you want to have to do. But it's this sort of thing, it's not a question of, is it anatomically correct? But it's a question of, does it feel right in the picture? And if it doesn't feel right in the picture, you have to change it whether you want to or not. Okay. This is quite a small portrait. A friend of mine who sat for me for probably close to a decade. She'd come in every week and sit for me, which was extraordinarily generous of her. And that's quite a bit smaller. And this one's also quite a small head. It's funny, you don't know till you actually paint somebody whether you're going to enjoy painting them or not. And Alan was really fun to do. You could really see the lights and darks and around his eyes. It was really lovely to paint. Yep.
Do you start with that drawing first?
I start, if I have a model for the first time, I always draw them. So I'll do a number of drawings just to try to see them clearly. So I'm working out a lot of my prejudices in the drawing, and then I feel as if I can go in and deal with the painting. But I don't tend to do drawings for a specific painting. I don't tend to do compositional sketches or so on. But I will, with a new model, I'll always draw just as a it's kind of an exercise in seeing. I brought this one in. This is the same model as in the nude over here. And I brought this one in because I gave a talk in December to the University Women's Club, and they said to me, why are your paintings so dark? I thought, well, I didn't know they were that dark. I thought maybe I'm just a dark person. But I brought this one in because there's a lot of color to it. And speaking to the figure, I mean, you can see from the portrait, you can see from the figure that she's a very outgoing, very kind of colorful person. And it was interesting because I've done a number of drawings of her, a number of large drawings, a very large nude that I did of her, a drawing. And those I had in a show at Glenhurst in Brantford, and she took her mother to see the show, and it was one of those things where her mother could not understand how she could be a life model. And she saw the show and she went, okay, I can understand. I don't know what she saw in it, but somehow she was reconciled to the fact of her daughter doing this. The other thing that was kind of funny with the one of Georgina is I'd gone to see the show again, because it's always interesting to see your own work hanging. You see it so differently than you do when it's kicking around your studio. It's just a bunch of junk against the wall. You actually see it hung, and it's as if it isn't yours anymore. You can really look at it. This woman said to me, oh, she saw this big nude of Georgina, and she said, that's me. I thought, great, that's good. Okay. And then this one is so totally different from the one of Georgina. I mean, with the one of Georgina, she's so out there, and this one, Simone, she's so introspective, just an entirely different feel to the painting. This one is part of a series. I never do series, but I did a series of small paintings. I decided I wanted to do small paintings, and the common dimension was 16 inches. They were all 16 inches high, and then varying widths. And I included this one because there's a self-portrait in it. Can you see the self-portrait? Yeah, that's me. And I'm actually doing, I don't have any very new pictures because I'm really terrible about taking pictures of things. I rely on other people to take pictures. So yeah, we'll look at the rest of them. So this is two, I sometimes have co-op students from Sheridan in my studio in the summer. They'll come and paint with me. And the one requirement is that they have to sit. So once a week, each one of them has to sit for us. So this was Joel and Emily, and I haven't done a lot of things with more than one model. I'd really like to do more. It just gets, if you have to pay people, it gets kind of expensive. And so this was actually, I think, characteristic of both of them. Joel was very agitated, and he had to read. It's a painting I'm kind of fond of, and again, it's not very big. It's only about that big. This is my partner, John Mieczniakowski, and I did this at his studio up near Owen Sound. I'm so used to working in my own studio. It's always hard working someplace else. This Christmas we've done a lot of still lifes together recently, and when I go up in the summer, I'll work in his studio, but it takes me time. I'm so used to my studio. It's where I work, it's where I'm comfortable. That it's hard for me to settle down to working there, and I'll do almost anything to avoid it. So he set up a still life, and he was working on a still life, and so I went in, and I didn't really want to do it, and I had paper, and I started it, and it was, and I had other things on my mind, mm-hmm. and all the time I was doing, I was going, I hate this, why am I doing this, this is awful, I can't see, and gradually, the actual drawing of it, the act of drawing kind of seduced me, and I started to forget about all of the things that were driving me crazy and the fact that I didn't want to do it and I didn't want to be there, and I became more and more involved with what I was doing. So anyway, that's kind of a bit of a ramble. John said he wouldn't have put the paper towels in it. There's one of his sculptures there. I think of the paper towels as a kind of homage to my father, who, if there was a plug and a wire on the wall, he'd paint it in. My mother would leave it out. And this is the same model in the white. And actually, you'll see a lot of, I think Christy in her wedding dress appears in a lot of backgrounds. The one of Nora in the white, the big one she's in behind there. And quite often I've got paintings in behind. I like working with the same model for long periods of time. You just start to feel comfortable with them. You get a sense of what they do. You need to be able to feel comfortable with the person. So if they, once you know them, you know how they move, you know the sorts of things that are natural to them. I don't like to impose on someone. Mm-hmm. So sometimes I'll have an idea, I think, oh, this would be good, but it turns out, they can't do that. They can do something else that's probably more interesting than what I had in my mind. Anyway, I think that's all. Oh yeah, I have a figure, I brought this figure in. This one's also quite small. It was funny, we got together and we were talking about what we were going to talk about, and both Christina and Tobi said, oh, you do so many nudes. And I actually do hardly any nudes. I probably do a nude a decade. So I thought I would bring another one in. And again, I think it's a complete. It's quite small. It's only about that big. And I think it's a real contrast to the one of Georgina. And then, kind of to finish up, I had a nice little quote. I can't go anywhere without notes. I have to prepare. So I found this great quote from the American choreographer Twyla Tharp. There was an article about her in The Spectator. And she says, basically, I do what I do to make discovery and to learn and to be surprised by something. And I think that's what painting is. I think it's something that surprises you. I think it's always new. I think you don't know what you're going to find. I think sometimes what you end up is entirely different from what you intended. But I think it's that sense of taking color and taking cloth and trying to make it into something that feels alive and feels true. Mm-hmm.
Thank you so much. We'll have time at the end for questions for the individual artists. And now I will introduce Christina Sealey, who is an artist and a musician also living in Hamilton. She holds an MFA in drawing and painting from the Edinburgh College of Art in Scotland and a BA honors from McMaster University. She's exhibited throughout Canada and the UK in both public and commercial galleries and artist-run centers, and regularly performs her music throughout Europe and North America. Through her work, she's been examining the relationship between place and identity and the intimate connections between people and the places that they inhabit. So welcome, Christina.
Thanks, Melissa. As Melissa mentioned, I was born in Hamilton, and I did my undergrad at McMaster. I went away to do my master's in Edinburgh, and when I came back, I had the idea in my head that I was going to move out of Hamilton and move to Toronto, and that was the place I needed to be in order to be a real artist. But then quickly discovered that Toronto was not affordable, and I wasn't going to be able to move there, so I put my name on a co-op list, a waiting list to get into an artist's residence in Toronto. And I thought, okay, I'll get things going in Hamilton in the meantime. And then after a year and a half, I got that call from the artist residence in Toronto. And by that time, I didn't want to move. And Hamilton had really become part of my work. And the people in the city, the atmosphere in the city, I just became enamored with that. And I felt like that was really a huge part of my work and my process. And that is the slides that you'll see today are based on people and places within Hamilton. I do work other areas as well too, but you know, Hamilton is where I live and where I experience and where I'm observing different places and how people are interacting. So I've done a number of different projects on Hamilton. The first painting was of part of a series I did based on night, so it was a particular period of time that I was looking at. And this was an area that I had seen by McMaster, and the mystery of this space really spoke to me, because you have this combination of this small area of forest and then the lights, which have this kind of mysterious quality. You don't know quite what they are, and I like that aspect of that particular place. The next slide, I've done a number of portraits of my friends, and similar to Katherine, I like working with people that I know, that I can experience and I have some kind of connection with. And Jesse Lanza is my studio partner, and my studio on James North at the moment. She's a musician, and she works with electronic music, and she's become quite well known for her music, and especially as a woman in electronic music, that is a little bit difficult. She's been inspiring to me, and this came out of that. I worked on a number of drawings, and this is from a series of drawings that I did, different portraits. This is also from the night series that I was talking about. And this is the model for this piece is also James Street, a shop owner and close friend that I came to know through having my studio on James North, where I've been since 2007. So there's been a lot of interesting changes on the street and during that time. And Holly has a shop called The White Elephant on that street. So I'm in contact with her quite a bit and coerced her into a number of paintings. And this one, in some ways why I'm interested in the Beaver Hall portraits and paintings is the way that they have abstracted some of the spaces that they're looking at, and that you'll see happening in my work quite a bit. So I have elements of realism and observation in my work, but areas that I have manipulated to create and intensify a particular moment. So this piece has that to it, a mysterious quality, again, like that forest, the light that you don't see, which was actually a flashlight that I had in her hand. So I had her come out and pose for me a number of times out around the city. But unlike Katherine, I did start off working solely from models, but I do now work a lot from photographs. So again, I'm manipulating that and kind of drawing on my experience of working from life as well, too. Another familiar space, this is Dundurn Stairs. That's near a location near where I live, which I was going up and down the stairs with my son when he was quite young, an interesting way to explore and for him to see the city. And I got, I was really attracted to this particular place, the elements of the light, the lights that come up the stairs, and the way the trees almost had a theatrical appearance to them. And that expanse of the city beyond, which I felt like had a kind of a hopeful quality to it, which I find a number of the in urban space paintings and drawings that I've done of the city, despite the fact that Hamilton's had kind of a some challenging reputation as well. But in my work, I think that that kind of hopeful quality comes out in a number of the paintings, and this one in particular. This is another James Street resident, another close friend, Gary Butcham, who's done a lot of renovations on that area of the street. And this is, I was attracted by the chaos of his apartment, and again, taking elements of that, and which is exactly. Yeah. Katherine also does have a really great chaotic apartment, or house, I should say. Lots of great things to draw. But this is what his space looked like to some degree. But I also love the elements that I was able to play with and repeat and abstract the same way I was doing with some of my other pieces, and again intensifying the atmosphere of the room, but still giving some character of my model. These two pieces, again, were part of the night series that I was painting. Holly, my victim from the stairs, was posing again here for this painting. And a familiar sight from Burlington Street, where you can see the factories of Hamilton. And again, I love that stretch of the street for that factory, looking at the factories and looking at them in terms of the light and the smoke that you see coming up. Again, I felt had an inspiring and kind of hopeful quality to it. Some might look at that and think of that as kind of dirty, but for me, it felt like it had an inspiring quality and something that was blooming and developing, I guess. And I like that contrast between the intensity of the city and that expanse of potential, I guess, in the sky. This piece is of myself and my son. So I've done a number of self-portraits over the years. They generally happen over a number of years, and this one was like that. Over, I guess, about 3 years it took me to actually finish this painting. So there's a lot of elements that came into it. And similar to the other pieces, and some this contrast between the chaos of my counter and the simplicity of the space that I was occupying with my son, sort of removing myself from the chaos of the everyday and there. But really about my relationship with him as well too, which if you've had children is can be both positive and challenging, and I think that there are a lot of both of those things happening in that painting. This was another series from my night series of paintings, and again based on Hamilton. This was from the Jolly Cut, and a similar feel to the Dundurn Stairs drawing that I did. It has, for me, an inspiring feeling, the idea of something magical happening in the middle of the city. You're not quite sure what has that sense of mystery to it, and intrigue, I guess, for me. That idea of the expanse of the city also explores the elements of chaos and rest that I have in some of my other paintings. And is this the last one, Melissa? Oh, a couple more. Okay, so a few more. This was an earlier piece, so I think about 2003. So the other ones that you've been looking at have been more recent paintings. This one, I did a lot more daylight-based paintings. They're filled with light. And this one in particular, the light is very important in this piece. This is a view from James Street South as you're coming down from the mountain and under the bridge, and then you have the city coming up beyond that. And at about 4 o'clock in the afternoon, you have the city almost glowing with light. And again, it had that feeling, inspiring feeling of potential of the city. In 2003, things I think we're still kind of developing in terms of Hamilton's reputation as well too. I think we're kind of on the upswing now, and at that point, things were still kind of I think in the middle of a shift. but for me, I felt like that the intensity of the light on the city kind of spoke to something that was in that process of change, kind of moving through that tunnel and coming out into something new. And then this piece, again, a similar quality of mystery to some of the others. I love just walking around the city, and certain things will catch my eye and then kind of play with me. And the construction workers, you see a lot around the city. It's always kind of, especially in the summer, it's kind of a continual level of construction happening. And usually a combination of sort of standing and action happening. I like this quality of this sort of these characters kind of not sure, they're sort of, we're not sure what they're doing. They're also kind of staring at this, the one man kind of going down into the depths of the underground of the city, and that element of mystery was there for me again in this painting. So you have that that contrast happening there under this idea that there's something unknown there that he's delving down into. So taking it out of just that context of being an image of some construction workers that I saw, it has these other elements to it. And again, this play between abstraction and realism is happening in this piece as well. Tying into my self-portraits, this was, again, an earlier one. Shortly after I had my son, the light is very important in this piece. This idea of transformation, I think, was important. I, at that time, reevaluating, who am I? I've had this baby. Am I a mother, or am I somebody else? Who am I? And personal space, and I think that came into this particular painting, sort of an examination of self. And this was in my studio space on James, and the window had been drawing me for a while. How am I going to use that intense quality of light? So you have again these elements of chaos and simplicity, which tie together a kind of elements of tension and that elements of rest or balance. And this is maybe the last one, I think. This was also a much earlier piece. I've been working from friends as models for a long time, including Katherine. I know, I could find my slides for you. And Thea is also a fellow artist as well. She's a textile artist, and she's been also working in the city, has a studio on James now as well too. But at that time, I had her come to sit for me, so she sat for life for this piece. And similar to the other pieces, I was interested in a balance of intensity, so all the color and intensity in her pose with this, the elements of rest around her. So you have that dynamic between the intensity of her personality and the space that expands into. So this was in my studio on James as well. It was one of the first paintings that I did in that space. So also exploring that space. There's nothing happening there in that room now. It's like, it's full of chaos. But at that point, it was all brand new and untouched. So that was part of that piece as well. So I think that's it for my slides. So my work mainly focused in on my experiences in Hamilton and creating that personal connection between people I'm working with, observing, and their connection to the spaces that they're living in.
Thank you, Christina. I forgot to mention that this is her painting, if you didn't already figure it out, on the right. Very characteristic of what you've seen. And now it's my pleasure to introduce Andrea Kastner, who is a Hamilton-based painter who makes work about the sacred nature of rejected things. She said, does that sound good? When she sent it to me. Her paintings of basements, alleyways, and trash bring to light the hidden underbelly of things we seek to ignore. Raised in Montreal, Quebec, and she's been living here for just over a year and a half now, mm-hmm. in Hamilton. She completed her Bachelor of Fine Arts at Mount Allison University. After finishing her MFA at the University of Alberta in 2012, she was included in the inaugural show at the Esker Foundation, which was called the New Alberta Contemporaries. And that same year, she was selected as a finalist for the RBC Painting Competition. Her work was included in The Lure of the Local, Women Artists in the Canadian Landscape at the Vores Museum in Athens, Greece. And her latest painting project, The Wasteland, toured to Kamloops, Montreal, Hamilton, Courtenay, and Dawson City in 2014. So welcome, Andrea.
Thank you. Thank you so much. It's such an honor to be asked to speak in the context of this amazing show and these artists, and I feel very sort of new to this whole scene, and especially to Hamilton with all the history. But one thing that connects me to the Beaver Hall show is that I grew up in Montreal, so I dug through my archives a little bit to find you some early work that had to do with the city, which you see in the paintings in the show. And then this is some work I was making when I first finished school. So I wanted to tell you a little bit about who I am as a artist. And so I did grow up in Montreal and spent a lot of my childhood playing in the alleyways and running up and down them with my brother and my best friend. And when I began to make artwork as a young artist, one thing I did was I discovered this bag of bags in my parents' back porch. And I think some of you might have something like this. It's like 20 years worth of plastic bags that you save just in case of something. So my parents are not hoarders in the strictest sense of the world, but they definitely have an odd relationship to physical objects, and that I think has influenced me as an artist as well. So when I was leaving for my fourth year of university, I took this bag of bags with me, thinking that it would make sense to me later, which it did. I started making collages of the alleyways that I missed in my home that was very far away, you know, trying to figure myself out as a young person. And I was using these bags, these neglected objects that are part of our daily lives but that we don't really see, to create these spaces that are similarly part of our daily lives. And I was so interested in just the texture of the city and using these bags as kind of a little bit like a marker of time and space. So the bus ticket has a timestamp, and all of these things have locations and times, and it's kind of code. So if you want to, I just think that all of these objects, all of this ephemera, and the way it connects to our cityscape and our lives has been a thread that goes through my artwork. So this is another, so I just basically made pieces of the entire alleyway that I grew up on. So all of my neighbors' houses, and I was thinking of the back of these houses as the anti-facade, so the sort of self that you are when you come to an event such as this and you're dressed like reasonably well and you you know, speak politely to people, and then this kind of alleyway side of ourselves, which we all kind of are in our private lives, and, like, things are just kind of thrown around. And it's like all the stuff that we're not particularly thinking about as something that we will be presenting to the world, but we still are. And there's a quality to that I've always really loved in terms of figuring out who we are as people. So we can go to the next one. So just, you know, the kind of objects that accumulate, the recycling, the toys, the laundry. I find a lot of that also connects to this show, like a lot of these kind of genuine ways that we present the spaces we inhabit. So all of these are made up of, you know, the liquor store bag and the little, like, changing kinds of bus tickets that connect us to the city. So that's the Montreal stuff. And then I moved to Edmonton in 2009 to do my master's degree. And I made a switch, like a pretty major switch. I wanted to learn how to paint. So at that point, I had been cutting up tiny, tiny bricks for 3 years. And I feel like I'd reached the end of the line for that whole investigation of bags and what they mean and the ephemera of our lives. So I started just like trying to do things in a slightly different way. And I was really interested in learning how to paint with oil paint. So the alleyways in Edmonton were a completely different looking object than in Montreal. There had been so much richness and sort of density and like all these little human lives that interact with each other. And then suddenly I was like, this vast, flat, far apart landscape was really confusing to me as a Montrealer. And there was this level of culture shock at the beginning, but I learned to find my way into it and to like fall in love with, I think, every city that I've moved to. But in Edmonton, being a master's student and having to sort of make artwork as quote-unquote research, which like is a odd thing, but we get used to talking about it that way, I decided that the thing walking up and down all these alleyways that I was going to do was to look at the garbage. So see that little garbage can? They were in the alleyways. The garbage collection was done at the different side of the house than I had been used to, and all these cans were in the alleyway. And one day I was going to my studio and I just picked up a bag and thought, you know, I'll just bring this with me and maybe if I have the courage I will look inside and see what I find. So with my like gloves and my mask, I just like started to unravel. I mean, no longer a bag of bags from my parents' bag. Like, this was like a bag of a complete stranger's garbage. And I would write notes on all the things I found, and I was thinking of myself as this kind of a detective, and I took pictures and wrote lists of all the things, and I was just kind of, I guess, still interested in how we live our lives and things that are private. And like, if the anti-facade, if the alleyway was the sort of casual, regular self, the garbage was the subconscious. The thing that we put in a black bag, put out and never want to see again. We don't want other people to know what's in it. We don't want ourselves to know what's in it. So I was just really trying to think of my artwork as glancing into this subconscious a little bit and examining something of the shadow side of ourselves and bringing it back into the things that we see. So in this one, just as an introduction, this bag, that one in the middle, had actually just wandered across the street in front of me one day, and I caught a quick picture of it, and it was like this manifestation of the way I'm looking at these objects as ghosts that are entering our lives or that are absent from our lives. so we can. And so this is another one of the garbage that I was looking at. And also, in the background, there's this building that was being demolished that I had taken a picture of. So at this point, instead of collaging objects to create a representation, I had just started collaging these photos that I had taken and making these diagrams that I then painted from. So you've got the orange peel and the three little stories of it and the three stories of the building, and just this kind of mystery, this clarity that comes from seeing something that we're not supposed to look at. And just the relationships, the things that were always under the surface. So back to this, so I'm thinking of myself as this kind of detective, psychologist, kind of looking at this hoarding and the sort of our relationship to objects. And then I had been also studying the wasteland, because the wasteland was kind of one of the texts that I was studying during my studies, during my master's degree. And this phrase within it was, "These fragments I have shored against my ruins." So I started looking at all of these constructions that people would have in their backyards, in the side of their houses, of just these collections of objects. These like weird little constructions that looked like sculptures, but were really just kind of things that we didn't even have room for inside of our houses, and started growing like barnacles around. So in the next picture, this one is called Noah's Ark. And I had walked through this alleyway, and somebody had a trailer with all of this plywood and all of these objects kind of piled really, really, really high. And like, this is a real thing. This isn't part of the collage aspect. This was like somebody's ark that was full of all their possessions that seemed to have this purpose. And I thought it was really fantastic. So that was something else that worked its way into all of this, all of my artwork going on. So this is then the show of, I just wanted to put this in the middle just as a scale thing, so that you have a sense of these landscapes or cityscapes as something that you can walk through and really experience a little bit in like a larger scale. There's those ones were part of a show in 2013. So this is just the beginning of, and then the garbage was also the counterpoint to that. At some point I was like, you know what, if I'm looking at other people's garbage, I think I'll look at my own too. So I would just get in there and be like, okay, let's see what's really going on. And I guess we can go through the rest of them kind of quickly. It's just more of an overview of the different ways that these facades or these things relate to us in our lives in a city, and the sort of things that lie underneath the surface, the unacknowledged, the shadow city. So there's this city that we live in, and then this whole landfill that is the other city. And at that point, I visited several landfills. I think it's in the next picture. There's, anyways, I had visited several landfills, and I was starting to collage those images of that trash into the cityscapes that had sort of pulled them aside. So there it is. That's the one I had thought of. This is a back of a building. In this, so I lived at that point in British Columbia, and this was the landfill. And I was thinking of it as having flooded through people's apartments, and all of those objects had come back to live where they had been removed from. there's a kind of a theory that like the world gets splintered, and then our job as human beings is to kind of bring it all back together. And usually that's in an emotional way or a connection, but I'm examining this connection between human and objects and painting as like as a collage artist, my own little bid to reconnect things that have separated. So that's that.
Thank you so much. And this is, of course, Andrea's painting here, which is not quite finished. It's a work in progress, but we like that, so we wanted to show that off. And since I'm not at all involved, I'm not at all ashamed to make a non-shameless plug about her exhibition, which is opening tomorrow night at $100 Gallery, Andrew and Stevens Gallery, which is on Cannon Street, just east of James, 7 o'clock. Tomorrow night during Art Crawl. It's free admission. Everything is for sale for $100. And Andrea will be there along with Manny Trin. It's a two-person show. So, did you want to speak about the response part?
Well, do you?
Yeah.
Allowed to change mics. It's all very technologically organized. So maybe it's 8 o'clock. Maybe what we can do is have you each go through again. We'll start with Katherine again, and just talk about, we'll sort of bring it back to the exhibition, your work. I learned things, especially with Katherine, because I know your work so well. And I learned, I've never actually heard you speak at length about certain aspects of your practice. So that was actually really, really interesting. And I'm dying to know what you're going to say about the Emily Kunin painting, which is part of our permanent collection. Those of you who know the collection know that this is a work. One of the Kunin's body of work is quite small. And I think it's safe to say that of the work that she has produced that we have found, the AGH holds two of the most intriguing works by Kunin, and I think this is one of them, and I think that's probably why Katherine. Over to you, Katherine.
Before I saw the exhibition and we had talked about doing this panel, I thought I would probably choose this painting. I was prepared to be surprised by something else, and I was really interested in the Jackson self-portrait, which I'd never seen before, and I think the Holgate self-portrait is also really beautiful. But I think to me this painting is the most moving and the most beautiful painting in the whole show. It's so simple. It's so straightforward. There's no narrative. There are no kind of charming nuances of color. I mean, the color is beautiful. It relates so well through the whole picture. It's not pretty. It's so quiet, and at the same time, it's so forceful. And I think that, I think Kunin was interesting. She was the most isolated of all the Beaver Hall painters. And in some respects, I think she isolated herself. I mean, she withdrew from exhibiting. Apparently, she continued to paint. And of course, all portraits are self-portraits. So everything you do, in some respects, is a self-portrait. So when you look at the painting, you see a girl in a chair, and you feel that she has an inner life. It doesn't really matter what it is. It isn't a story, but it's such a reflection of the artist and her feelings, about. Just her response to the actual painting of this girl in a chair. And it's like you think of an artist like Chardin painting a copper pot. It's just a copper pot. How could you look at a copper pot and feel moved to your core? And I think that for me, that's what the Emily Kunin does. And I think the other thing that's interesting when you look at the show, I think she's one of the artists who actually transcends her period. So some of the paintings that you look at, they all obviously look as if they were done at that time. None of us can escape our time, but I think the Kunin doesn't date. I think she's of her period, but I think she also transcends her period.
Thank you. Well said. Okay, we'll go on to the next one. Okay, so Christy's going to talk about two works by Prudence Heward.
We have the artists in the Beaver Hall group
There's a lot of amazing pieces that I was drawn to, but Prudence Heward's work really spoke to me personally in her approach to her painting. Her bold use of color was something that I think stands out, and I think stands out for that group in particular as well, too. They're making a shift in how they were painting, how they were observing, and their, particularly the theater piece, and her abstraction of the forms in the background in combination with her more observational painting approach was also really interesting to me. And again, I think was something that was new to that Montreal audience and something that was unique and had a modern feeling to it. But it is also an element that speaks to my own work and the way that I'm working with the figure and how I'm observing places. The theater piece in particular, I think it gives that moment of a particular place and time, but it has something else that's timeless to it in the way that the abstraction and the intensity of the shapes within the composition become work together to create something that that goes beyond just that moment in the theater, and it becomes a even more of just an interesting visual image for me. The fact that the girls aren't turned towards the viewer also struck me as well. She wasn't concerned with having that beautiful portrait of the girls, more about that moment in the theater and that experience of that particular space. Similarly with her portrait of the sisters, it also struck to me again in her manipulation of the space. So you have some kind of element of place within the painting, but it does take on a more abstract quality, and that rhythm, the movement of the shapes adds to the atmosphere of the painting. Her observation of the girls is also, I think, interesting in that they have, particularly the one in the chair above, quite a strength to them. You get a sense of their personality, and as a woman painter painting at that time, and I think representing women and girls in painting, I think that was also an interesting aspect to me, spoke to me in that work.
Thank you. And now we have Andrea. We'll finish with Mabel May. This work is actually not hanging here, but that's okay, because now you get to see it, not in the flesh, but it was in the iteration in Montreal, but Andrea chose this work.
I did. Actually, my family had gone to see the show when it was in Montreal, and they had come to me with the catalog, you need to see this. And I was like, well, what a coincidence. I've actually just been asked to talk about it. I guess it really is something very dear to me. And I was thinking, listening to the both of you talk about your works, that all three of us are people who, we're just really plugged into the surface of the world around us, looking at people and seeing their personalities and thinking of their bodies as these things that you can paint. And then for me, looking at the city and thinking of the skin of the buildings, and just my love for brick walls and these kind of things. And so when I saw this Mabel May one, there's a feeling that I wanted to describe when you have been painting a cityscape, like that side of that building for a while, and you've just been really, really connecting with it and feeling it and making those colors. And then you actually walk out of your studio and you see the actual building that you've just been spending all that time painting, it blows your mind. It is a very, very strange feeling. And that's just been happening to me because, as you said, I have that thing and I've been falling in love with Hamilton through painting just these last couple of weeks. And getting to know this place that you've been painting for 10 years. And so I was just thinking, if I were Mabel May, if I was this woman in the 1920s sitting in my studio, to me this painting gives me such a strong sense of her feeling for that city and her love for that city and just her love of the way the sun reflects on these buildings and the coziness of being in your studio when there's snow outside and observing the beauty of those hanging pieces of laundry. And yeah, this was just my way of trying to be this person 100 years ago doing the same thing, and just the fascination of the fact that we're still thinking of these same ideas this far down the road.
I have to say it was really fun. Once we asked our guests to pick a painting in the show, and then we're waiting to see what it was going to be. And then as soon as you all emailed them or I said what it was going to be, they perfectly clicked. Like, I saw that, and I hadn't seen this image before, but I right away I thought, that's perfect for you. And then when you said yours, I thought, that's perfect for you. Girl in a dotted dress, of course. It was like, I didn't know that, but as soon as you chose it, I thought they were just the right thing. But we have time for questions now. Does anyone have a question for the artists? Yes.
I wondered how helpful you find criticism.
Depends on whose it is. Or I don't have it depends on whose it is, yes.
Did everyone hear the question?
No.
We're just wondering how much you appreciate criticism. How helpful is criticism?
Yeah, I think for me, it can be hard to take criticism, but ultimately, after you've had a little time to let it digest, I think it's really important to get that feedback, even if it's something you disagree with. And then tying back to the Beaver Hall exhibition, I know they received a lot of criticism for the work that they were doing, especially the jazz wall in particular. If I'm wrong, but I think that they continue to do what they felt strongly about, even though they did have that criticism. But I think having that there is important, and you have this dialogue that starts. So
I'd have to say I don't appreciate uninvited criticism. I have no interest in someone telling me they don't like something that I've done. I have no interest in that at all. I have certain people whose opinions I trust about my work, and I will ask them, and if they think there's something that isn't working in a piece, I don't want to hear it, but I will listen, and quite often I'll change it. But yeah, I don't like uninvited criticism.
When you mentioned that, it makes me think we were thinking about talking a little bit about community and like the sense of a community of artists, and the fact that these people had this community of artists, and I think within that, that's where criticism really works, is when you are working with people and you start to feed off each other's ideas, mm-hmm. and you start to see their struggles and your struggles as, you know, feeding off each other. And in that context, that's like the context where criticism lives and like helps us as artists. Mm-hmm.
So the question is it true that the artist is her own worst critic?
Do you mean in the sense of thinking your work is terrible?
Well, that your work is never quite maybe finished, or what you want,
yep.
what you're trying to achieve.
I think that's absolutely true. Yeah.
Yeah. I guess that's all part of your development as well, too, continually re-examining your work. If you didn't do that, then your work wouldn't grow. So I think it's an important element to have.
I mean, your worst critic would just tell you to stop making art and like go get a job. There's a certain point to which like the like hubris that takes us to keep doing these things means that we're not our worst critics. we have like. There's stages of self-doubt. In your worst stage, you're your own worst critic. But otherwise, you're like, cool, I'll keep making more.
Catherine, you made reference to before you would start to paint
Uh-huh.
I was just curious what that meant.
Oh, I think that we make assumptions all the time about what we're seeing, about things that we experience, things that we see. So if I'm drawing or painting someone, even if it's someone that I know really well and I've never drawn them before, I have ideas in my mind about what I think they look like. And then I start drawing and I go, they don't look like that at all. You know, this person has a long nose and this is this and this is that. And then you start drawing, you go, they don't look anything like that. So it's working out those things. It's trying to be just as open as you can to what's there and not kind of letting your own issues get in the way.
Lisa.
What do you think people will think of your paintings in 100 years' time?
Are you asking? yeah, that's a good question. I don't know. Hopefully, they're still looking at them. But you know, if they're still around at that time, I don't know. For me personally, I guess I can, looking at my work, it has that and like a historical element, kind of like the Beaver Hall Group work, where you're looking at a particular place and you have that element of looking back and seeing one person's experience of that place. So there's, you know, landmarks of the urban landscape that would be, I think, something that people would see from that, but like in some way similar to the exhibition when we're looking at their views of Montreal at that time. I don't know if you got.
I was looking at this show and thinking about it, and One thing that occurred to me might be that, like, artists, like, throughout the ages, maybe we alternate between, like, really investigating closely our emotional reality and, like, our physical reality. And these guys seem to be in a phase where they were just really clued into the physical skin of, like, the city that they were living in and looking out the windows and seeing everything for what it really is and looking at each other. And I think that maybe we do that, like the three of us. Like that's one way in which we are, the pendulum has swung back and forth a couple of times, and now we're really invested in looking at the world as it is. And so in 100 years, if any of us are lucky enough to still have artworks that aren't like, you know, in a dump somewhere, like...
I'm thinking of flea market.
Or a flea market. Yeah. But if we're lucky enough that our art's still around, then people will be able to see like the way humans looked, or the way the city looked, like fixed in this moment in time.
The observation of things that were important to us at that time, too, because you're looking at garbage as well, too. And
yeah.
That's like an element of.
Well, that garbage
this
isn't going anywhere.
Too.
those landfills.
It
will
says
be.
Something about our time period, too, though, I think.
Yeah. One last question. Thank you.
We know that 100 years ago, the Beaver Hall Group women, they were struggling to go on the. As an artist, because of gender, do you feel any obstacle of today being like independent women having exhibition, everything? Do you think gender is still a factor?
Mm. So I'll just repeat the question in case everyone can hear. But how does it work? Obviously, the women working 100 years ago had obstacles because of their gender. Is that still a factor today?
Well, I think like we see it in the news. I mean, all the time. Every time they do a survey to see how many male artists versus female artists have had solo exhibits in like public institutions, it's usually about 70% or 80% male or whatever. So that's got to come from somewhere. I mean, this thing that you guys are doing, I'm so appreciative. Like you, like there's so many women up here talking about art in a public institution. It's really exceptional. But like you know, just little things. Like for example. My husband is an artist as well, so we're two artists living in the same household, and we just had a child this year. And when my baby was 3 months old, my husband went off for 6 weeks to go do an art residency in the Yukon. And now my son
she
just...
She also had a two-year-old at home.
Yes, that too. And then my son is one now, and I'm going off for a month to do an artist residency in Vermont. And people are like, are the children going to be okay? Are you going to be okay? And I was like, no one asked Colin that, like, when he was going. Like, nobody seemed to think the children would be damaged with their father away for 6 weeks. Like, the kids were going to be fine, but I was like, they have their dad, they're going to be okay too when I leave. And it's just like, I mean, it's not the same, because obviously, like, a baby is breastfeeding, there's certain biological, like, details that, but still, I think there's, like, there's just these little cultural assumptions that we're working out, like, how people, whether they take women artists seriously or how they think about the family, and yeah, we're just working these things out. It takes many years, I think, to change culture.
Yeah, but even logistically talking about children, I mean, you know, as a woman, you are, you're carrying the child and you're caring for them when they're first born for quite a while, and that does impact on art career for sure. I mean, and I think that is it's still a challenge, just like logistically and physically a challenge for female artists that. You know, that can't be taken away, so that is a challenge. But I mean, I think with the Beaver Hall group, a lot of the women in that group chose not to have children.
That's right, in fact, yeah.
Yeah, and I was just thinking that could be, you know, it's a major factor. They had obviously a lot of other challenges as well, but that's a choice as an artist or as someone working in a kind of a similar profession that you have to make, how you're going to work with that. And obviously, I mean, we all have kids, so it's not impossible. And
in some ways, as far as having children, if you're an artist, my daughter, when she was little, used to come in the studio and draw when I had a model, and now my granddaughters do. So they come, they'll bring their paints, and they'll...
Put up your hand, Ray Bates. Yeah. Katherine's right there. Katherine's daughter, Ray Bates, who's an artist, and her daughters are also... So it's now, what, 4 or 5 generations of artists in the family?
I'm going for orthodontists.
Okay.
I want orthodontists.
No, that's a very interesting point, I think, to end on, because when we were meeting in advance of this and we talked about this issue of, it was an excellent question, we talked about this issue of motherhood and sacrifices that need to be made, and all of the women that were involved with the Beaver Hall group, only 2 married. Regina Sidon shortly stopped painting after she married and to look at, you know, to raise a family, and Lilias Torrance Newton married in 1920, the year the group formed, and divorced in 1933, the year she painted that large nude of her, that large nude portrait in the same year. And the rest of the women chose to have a very different and very unorthodox life in the 1920s in Montreal, in large part because we believe they wanted to be able to make work, be artists first and foremost, that was their identity. They were artists. And so with that, I want to thank our 3 speakers. This was absolutely extraordinary.
Thank you.
That's by far the most applause ever for a talk that I've been at. You know, when I said we wanted to make historical work relevant and present and alive, I can't imagine having 3 people who are more eloquent and articulate and to be able to make these connections with those paintings and your practices. So on behalf of everybody here at the Art Gallery of Hamilton, thank you very much.
Thank you.